impotent Christian. Our text this morning, we read here in 2 Kings chapter 6, telling us about a problem this young seminary or this young ministerial student was having. This young minister or student lost his axe head. He lost his cutting edge and he lost his effectiveness in doing his work. The scripture tells us of a school for the ministry had grown to the point that they needed to provide a new facility. And as they are in the process of cutting down trees to build their new school, one of the prophets or ministers loses his axe head in the Jordan River. And he becomes very distraught because the axe head was borrowed. And as a consequence of losing that axe head, he was unable to continue his work. He had lost his cutting edge. He cried out to God's man, Elisha, and the great prophet performs a miracle, and the axe head floats to the surface, and the man puts out his hands, and he picks it up again. Now, we may look at this story and wonder if there is anything here for the modern Christian. There is. I believe there's plenty here for us to learn. You see, the axe head represents the power to get the job done. No one can chop down trees by flailing away at it with just an axe handle. It takes the sharp, biting power of the axe head to eat through the wood and to drop that tree. So we need to realize that without our cutting edge, that is the power of the Holy Spirit, we will never be able to serve the Lord properly, nor will we be able to make a dent in this world for the Lord, for the cause of Christ. We need God and His power to get the job done for His glory, and we may be able to operate our churches, and we may be able to operate our programs in our lives apart from the power of God. And unfortunately, there's a lot of people and a lot of churches doing just that. But we will never make inroads into the world apart from the power of God. We will never be able to serve the Lord in an effective manner until we perform that service in His power and His power alone. Folks, if we've lost our cutting edge for the Lord, we need to ask God for help to get it back. And so I challenge you this morning as we look at these verses to search your own heart and search your own life. Because I believe some of us here today might need to think about our prayer life and our Bible reading and our devotion time and our church attendance and all those things. Because when those things begin to skip, or we begin to neglect those things, as I'll get in further, then we start to lose something. We start to lose that power. You see, if you know, and I've chopped some wood in my life. Now, I know this younger generation, they don't know nothing about that. Maybe they pull the lever on the wood. But if you don't, hard work. If you don't take proper care of your axe, that head will begin to get hurt. And it'll continue to get worse and worse. And then finally you'll sling it and it'll just fly off. And hope you don't hit somebody when you find out. But let's look at the verses. 2 Kings chapter 6, verses 1 through 7. And it says, "And the sons of the prophets said unto Elijah, Behold now, the place where we dwell with thee is too strait for us." In other words, it's too small. We're growing too big. That's a good problem. "Let us go, we pray thee, unto Jordan, and take thee thence every man a beam." Now I want you to look at that, every man a beam. Leaves nobody out, does it? Means everybody's got a responsibility. "Take thence every man a beam, and let us make us a place there where we may dwell. And he answered, Go ye. And one said, Be content, I pray thee, and go with thy servants. And he answered, I will go. So he went with them, and when they came to Jordan, they cut down wood. But as one was hauling a beam, the axe head fell into the water, and he cried and said, "Alas, alas, master, for it was borrowed." And the man of God said, "Where fell it?" And he showed him the place, and he cut down a stick and cast it in thither, and the iron did swim. Therefore he said, "Take it up to thee." And he put out his hand, and he took it. Let us pray. Father, I thank you again for this day. I thank you, Lord, for your blessings. I thank you for the songs this morning, the spirit we felt here already, God. And Lord, as we come to you, Father, I pray you will speak through me. Lord, I'm a nobody. Just want to tell everybody about you who is somebody. God, I pray, Father, that you'll speak through me this message, that you'd have us to hear, Lord. And God, may we all take it to heart, Father. Always, we must be on top of our relationship, our walk with you. We must not let anything be neglected, Lord, or we will begin to lose our accent. God, we want to continue to have that spiritual power, God. We want to stay in contact with you, Lord, doing your will, your work. In Jesus, I pray. Amen. The first point is here, is the impotent Christian must be concerned. Concerned about their spiritual situation. If we're going to recover our edge, in other words, we must first come to the place where we realize we no longer have it. This morning, I want us to be like this young prophet. As this young man was busy working, at his axe head flew off and it fell into the water. He realized that something was missing, and without it, his efforts were in vain. I'm convinced that many church people are walking through life thinking that they are filled with the Spirit of God, doing the things that they normally do, but they don't realize that they have lost the power of God because they're not in that true fellowship with God like they ought to be. They're letting things slip in their lives. You may say, "Preacher, I'm saved. The Spirit of God is in my heart." Yes, but is the Spirit of God working in you and through your life? I mean, is the Spirit of God, or is it laying dormant in your life? I want us to be like this young prophet this morning. Some of us have lost our zeal. Some of us have lost our will. Some of us have lost our testimony. And others have lost their way. But do we realize it? Do we realize? I want us to say, I want us to come realize that, you know, if we've lost it, I want us to realize and say, "I want it back. I want my passion back. I want my fire back. I want my burden for the lost back. I want my joy in the Lord back. I want my devotion with God back. I want to glorify God in my body. I want all that back. I want my prayer life back. I want my alone time with God back. My personal relationship. I want my church fellowship back." This young man could have just pretended nothing happened and just kept wailing away. You see, I believe there's a lot of Christians that way today. He could have continued to attempt to chop down that tree without even causing a dent in it, just swinging that axe handle. Could have just kept going through the motions and acting like he's getting it done. But you see, I believe there's a lot of Christians that same way today. Why? They've lost something. Many are today just like this impotent Christian. Many today are just like that. Why? Because we're letting little things in our lives that should not slip. But may I remind you this morning, there's nothing in the world more important than your prayer time and your devotional time with Jesus. Nothing. Your job's not more important than your time in the morning with the Lord. Is more important than your time with the Lord, my friend. And if you let that time slip, then your axe head begins to get loose and your power to get the job done in the name of the Lord begins to get weaker and weaker. When we let things in our lives become more important and we get more involved in those things, and the devil loves you get involved in things. The devil will whisper to you, you're fine today, don't worry about praying, you got too much to do, let's get with it. Huh? I mean, if you woke up in the morning and you've been just that, man, I got to get on it, I got to get going, it's a busy day. It's a busy day. I love what Charles Stanley said. Stop and pray. Two works better than one. Stop and pray. Get God involved in your life. Get God with you first thing in the morning. So you understand what I'm saying. You know, many of us, we've lost many church members. What happened? They quit praying. They quit reading their Bible. They quit coming to Sunday school. They quit church out. They quit hanging around with their Christian friends. They got so involved in everything else, thinking that that was more important. And the next thing you know, they're out of church. They don't realize how far away they got from God. They don't realize. You see, this young man realized they were surprised. And I'm going to tell you something. If you've lost your relationship with God, you're not where you was at one time. And until you realize it, it's not going to get any better. All the times that I've had people meet me right here and say, preacher, I want my relationship back with God like I used to have. Well, go back where you left it and pick it up again. Pick up the prayer and the Bible reading, your devotion time with God. Go back and pick it up. Amen? Go back and pick it up. How many times also have discouragement stopped us? How many times? Friends, discouragement is no excuse for sitting down on God. You know, this guy could have said, well, you know what? I'm just gonna sit down over here. I'm just gonna let them keep on doing it. He could have found a nice shade tree. I've lost my axe head. I'm just gonna sit down and watch others. Too many have done that too. Couldn't. Too many have done that. Many people got hindered a little bit too. Just want to sit down. Discouraged. Use that excuse, but I want to tell you, there's no excuse for sitting down on God. God expects us to work and serve Him. Verse 2 says that every man, again, as I already pointed out, a being. They didn't expect anyone else to do their work for them. Do you realize, as a child of God, God has called you into the family of God to do a service for the Lord, to do a work in the family of God. You've got your load to carry. Don't expect somebody else to carry your being. Every man is on being. You know, it's sad, but they say only 5% of the church members do the majority of the work in every church. That reason? Should it be that way? No. Every man is on being. Every person is on being. We need to be about serving God. So the lessons is here about the tools that God has also anointed every person, every one of us with, and how we are to carefully look at them and survey what God has given us and use them for the glory of God. And we need to pay attention. Friend, an axe head does not come loose again all at once. You know, I've seen people come and go. I've been here for over 20 years now. I've seen people come and go. I've seen some come and then boom, they're gone and never see them again. Then I've seen some, that majority, they'll come a little bit. They start missing a little bit. And then a little bit more, and the next thing you don't see them anymore. You don't see them at all. COVID was the greatest excuse for people to get out of church and never come back. What happened, preacher? What happened to these folks? It's called neglect. And they don't even realize they're doing it. They neglect their prayer life. They don't get up and pray anymore. They neglect their time in the Bible, just hearing from God what God has to say. They neglect their time coming to church. back out in the world. They have no testimony. They have no power in the name of the Lord to help anybody. To help anybody. You start neglecting those things, and then when somebody seriously needs God, how are you going to help? You neglect those things in your life, how are you going to help somebody when they come crying to you and they don't know Jesus and they need some help? They need some guidance. What are you going to do if they're looking at your life and they see you back out in the world? Because of neglect. If you're not careful, you don't realize you're losing something. But also, I want you to know, you must be concerned enough to cry out. You see, I will tell you something. Until you know, a person gets to the point where they're concerned about their personal walk with God, they're not going to do anything about it, and ain't nothing you can do about it. I've told you before, when I first had my first church, I killed myself. For about 4 years, I was going and going and going to knocking on those doors, old church members. God told me until they realize where they are and what they need, I'm just wasting my time. Concerned enough to cry out. This young man cried out in despair. Immediately after losing the axe head, this young minister stopped doing what he's doing, and he looks and he cries out to this man of God, Elisha, this man who's representing God there. He cries out to him. We see that something was needed. He knew that something is missing. But I want you to know, admitting that the axe head was gone, he was also admitting to the fact that it had become loose and that had not bothered to tighten it. We got to make sure we stay close to God through prayer, through Bible study, all those things. You know, sometimes it's a hard pill to swallow, but it's necessary to recover here. It's the fact that we got to realize that we need to and cry out that we need that axe head back, and we need to understand that it got loose because of neglect on our part. Stay on top of it. You see, we need honest hearts today. What are you talking about, preacher? We need people honest enough to cry out and say, I just don't have the fire that I used to have. I'm not as close to God as I used to be. I'm not serving the Lord like I once did. What we need are honest hearts that will tell the truth about their condition and their relationship with God. We just need to come clean and tell the Lord the truth. And why not? He knows the truth anyway. No excuses. We just need to come to God. I'm letting you. God, I need to get into prayer. I need to get back into the Word of God. I need to get in church. I need to get involved in ministry. I need to get with it. We need to learn the path back to the altar. When's the last time you've been to the altar? You want to tell me you just got it together all year long, year after year, you've always got it together, you don't need this altar? You've not neglected any prayer, no Bible study, no church, no ministry. You've not neglected anything, you're right on top of it. You don't need the path back to the altar. I'm telling you, the devil got you right where he wants you. Why is it that when I was a child, I could remember the altar just being worn out? People kneeling and weeping. For one reason out of the other, one for sadness, one for joy, one for gladness, one for just pleading for somebody to get saved. Well, why can't we get back to the altar? God's so far away, our axe head is just falling off. We have no power to cut into nothing. him, and we need his power in our midst. And you know, sometimes it's pay a price, and that is we got to confess that where we are, that we got to confess that we're lacking it, and we need to be concerned about it enough to cry out to God. God, help me. I believe that somebody today needs to confess, I just don't have the zeal I used to have. I believe somebody needs to confess, I'm not as close to God as I used to be. We need honest hearts that will tell the truth about their condition. Are you concerned enough to tell the truth where you are? I know this is a hard message, but I think it's a time we all need. Let's not forget this is a young ministry. We need help. Times when no pastor needs to hear. And I need my focus that it starts in prayer. And it starts in getting into the Word of God. It starts with my time with God. Keeping my time valuable with God. Before we will ever recover what is missing as an individual and as a church, we must first come to the place that we are honest and admit what's wrong. The power to serve the Lord does not come from within our own human nature. It comes from the Lord. May we never take it for granted. May we never. Paul tells us to be filled with the Spirit, which leads me to know that the Spirit dwells in us richly. We must be active in His healing power. We must be active. We must honestly come to God and say, I just don't have the fire I used to have. I'm just not as close as I used to be. I need that power. We need to realize it. We need to be concerned about having that power of God. The next point is we need to be concerned about it being borrowed. The Bible tells us here, it was not his, it was borrowed. And furthermore, his pain tells us that he had no sufficient means to pay or to replace it. Preacher, where are you going with that? Think about this. The iron back then was really expensive. How expensive is your salvation? If someone had loaned it to him the axe, he would not be able to work it to begin with. Have you ever considered the fact that all of our abilities, all of our resources, all of our talents, everything that we have is borrowed from God? As Craig said this morning, we came into this world with nothing, and we are going to leave with nothing, and everything we have has been borrowed from God. Amen? Borrowed. Everything we have has been lent to us by God. Friend, everything you have is owned, lent to you from Almighty God. The cutting edge is not our own. It is His. What I'm trying to tell you, it doesn't belong to us. It belongs to Him. And at last he cries. He says, at last. In other words, he's expressing emotional pain until you come to realize your loss, accept responsibility for it, and weep over it. You'll never have that anointing again. The loss of the anointing of God is the most terrible loss a child of God can experience. If you will not weep over it, you will not become. God has given us gifts and talents for the purpose of furthering on the cause of the ministry, His ministry. Are we using the tools that God has given us, or have they sunk into the bottom of the river? We need to realize that all that we have by the grace of God. Everything that we have belongs to God, and we are simply in the stewardship position, caring for what belongs to God. If we're going to serve the Lord and see eternal results from our service, we must accept the fact that we are unable to do the work within ourselves, and we need the power of God. We need borrowed power. The Holy Spirit of God. In us, working through us. May we understand that the same God who so freely saves the sinner will also freely give you the power to carry out the ministry and to use your talents and your tools that He has given you to the ends of the means. I'm telling you. Also, we are also living a life that is borrowed. It's borrowed time. Borrowed time. This young man was wailing away, and the axe head flew off, and he says, guess what? That ain't mine. It's borrowed. Ain't nothing yours. It's borrowed. What are you going to do with what's been lent to you by God? By saying the axe had been borrowed was an acknowledgement that it would have to be returned. Have to be returned. You realize you're not staying here forever, right? Yeah. Judgment day's coming, right? We got to stand before God and give an account to Him for the things that He has lent us and what we are doing with them. All that borrowed stuff. You people out here with beautiful voices, what are you doing with it? Huh? You people out here with talents, all kinds of talent, what are you doing with it? That God has given you? What kind of ministry through the abilities that God has given you that you can do? Because you're going to stand before God one day. And we've only got so much time, borrowed time. We don't know how much that God's going to give us time. But boy, I tell you what, we need to be working and working and working. And we don't need to allow the axe head to get loose. We don't have time to not be praying. We don't have time not to be in the Word of God. We don't have time not to be going to church and make it a priority. Everything's borrowed. I think that the lesson is crystal clear. When we are working for the Lord as we should, we are operating with borrowed power, borrowed talents, and borrowed time. And we need to make the most of it. Amen? Amen. The second main thing. We must confront the situation. You see, he cries out. He cries out to Elisha. And Elisha said, well, where'd it fall? Where'd you lose it at? Wouldn't it be great if spiritually every time we lost an axe head that we would call out to God and ask for Him? Call out to God and ask Him to help you. I want you to know that God loves you, and you can call out to God, and He will help you. And as soon as this axe head hit the water and it sunk to the bottom, he's calling out to Elisha. This is God's man. This is a representative from God. Not God, but his representative. And he calls him and says, look, this is what happened. I've lost my axe head. Sometimes you might need to call a Christian friend and ask him to pray for you and hold you accountable to your walk with your walk. But what did Elisha say? Said, where'd you lose? You're here today and you want to tell me, preacher, I'm not walking with the Lord like I used to. Where'd you lose? Where? And the prophet, the minister said, right there. It went down right there in the mud. It's down in the water. Elisha, right there. Folks, if we ever get to the point where we've lost our cutting edge in doing God's work, we need to remember that our cutting edge was left where we last left. Maybe we need to ask ourselves more questions than like, you know, Lord, did I lose it? Did I drop it because I dropped out of Sunday school? Lord, did I lose it because I no longer attend church service regularly? Lord, did I lose it because I'm not praying like I should? Lord, did I lose it because I've got angry with somebody? Did I lose it because I got jealous over something? Lord, where did I lose my cutting edge? Where did I lose that power that I need to continue serving God? I mean, there's so many things that we could use to illustrate. Where did I lose it? Did I lose it because I just neglect the Word of God? Maybe did I lose it because I'm feeling a little doubts about the Word of God? Where did I lose it? We must uncover the reason why the power has been forfeited now. And if it's because of some sin, too, maybe that we've committed, we need to come forward. We need to confess that to God. We need to come clean. If we were honest this morning, we could all pinpoint areas of our lives that stand between us and our having that glorious power of God like we really should. We need to come back to that point and make a course correction. If we have the courage to talk, to take a deep and serious look, in other words, at our lives, our personal spiritual lives, and discover where and why we lost our cutting edge. And I want you to know that the point that Elijah comes and said, where did you lose it, shows us that God is concerned. I want you to know God is concerned about you. God is concerned about your relationship. God is concerned when you're not praying. God is concerned when you're not reading His Word. God is concerned when you miss church. God is concerned when you're walking away from Him. Nobody likes to see their children walk away. Nobody likes to lose their communication with their kids. Do you realize that? God feels the same way. You know, I was listening to this guy. He was a black guy. He played in sports and he played professional football. And he was talking about him getting hired for coaching jobs. And he was hired from like 7 different high schools. And you know, before he was 42, he had coaching jobs. But he said I went into all of those. He went into all of them with the right reference, except for the first one. He said, I was in professional football. I knew all these coaches. I knew all these people. So I went in there and I told them about all these wonderful people I know, all these great professional football players. All I told them. And he said, I didn't get hired. He said, I walked away from there and I was just, you know, excited about myself. And then the Lord says, you told them everybody who you knew except me. You didn't tell them you knew me. He said, from then on, all 7 other jobs are the first thing he told them. I said, I want you to know something about. I know the Lord Jesus Christ is my Savior. He said, I got hired all 7 days. How's our relationship? God cares about you. This man loses his axe head. There's 7, I don't know how many is there. It's much. Every man has said, I don't know how many. But God cared enough about this one. And he used his prophet Elijah to help him get that axe head back. So I want you to understand, first and foremost, God is concerned and God does care about you personally. I don't want you to lose that. And what does he do? He takes that stick and he takes that stick and he cuts it. You know, that man represents the cross. He took wood, you know, and he threw it in there. And the axe head rose to the top. Thank God for that resurrection power of God. Just as the man of God had faith when he cut down that stick and threw it in the water, that God would raise that axe head, you too must have faith that God can raise you up from your problems and restore you again brand new, wherever you are in your walk. Amen. So I'm preaching this message not to discourage you, but to encourage you. Stay with your prayer life. Stay in the Word of God. Stay in church. Stay in a ministry. Do something for God. river and flew back on that axe handle and bent tight, and he could have went right back to the river. It didn't happen that way. You see, the axe hand floated. And Elisha says, now, do you want it back? Do you want it back? Do you want that power of God back in your life? Do you want it back right there in your skin? Wherever you are, go back. Whatever you've neglected, go back and get it. Go back into that prayer life. Go back into your prayer closet. Go back into that daily devotion with God. Go back to church regularly. Get back into a ministry of God. Take it back. I want to tell you what's happening now. The devil said to somebody, he's not talking to me. He's not talking to me. You're doing it right. You're doing it right. Brother, he's not talking to me. Something you neglected, and that axe head hit just a little bit. You reckon you need, might need to pay a little bit of attention to that. Because if you don't, let me tell you what's happening. It's going to continue to get worse. It's going to continue to get worse. You're going to lose your faith. Somebody used to have that good old tight, sharp axe, and you'd spin that thing, and man, the chips were flying. Trees were falling. God was being glorified in your life. And then, you know, all of a sudden, the axe head flew up. Are you concerned enough to dry up? Do you realize where you are? Do you realize how it happened? Are you ready to get back for the glory of God? You see, it's all about the glory of God. Let's remember, everything you got, everything you have has been borrowed from God. The purpose of it is to be used for the glory of God. And so are you doing what you're supposed to be doing with what you got borrowed? Because remember, time